conducts a quartet that sang well-known and popular songs. Our repertoire was not sophisticated, but in spite of that, as the days went by, the group of listeners became larger. Slowly but surely, we became accustomed to invite us to other barracks for secretly organized evening events. Among the thousands of men who lived in our camp, there were all sorts of talents to be found. It wasn't long before other performers joined us in our evening events to get a few moments of escape for themselves. These performance events were unforgettable experiences. Favorite literary passages brought to recite from memory, and of course, there was much singing. Needless to say, these events had an extraordinary psychological effect on all of us, because they helped us overcome depression, and we were all aware that depression, unattended to, brought inevitable death. Personally, I do not hesitate to say that I owe my life to those moments. I can honestly say that singing saved my life.
Time. assigned to conduct the execution of these prisoners as a deterrent. I was one of the eyewitnesses, one of those who stood closest to what went on. As the 30,000 prisoners stood at the roll call square in full silence, the procession of the 12 began. Surrounded by block leaders, they ascended the gallows barefoot, clothed only in denim. Their hands were tied in fire as they stepped up on their stools and, one by one, faced the motionless columns of prisoners whom they could now see through the ovals of their halters. Then, they put the nooses around their necks. As the commandant began reading the sentencing decree aloud, a startling thing occurred. Without waiting for the reading to end, a youngster, known throughout the camp as Kaminsky's brother, kicked the stool on which he was standing with as much strength as he could gather and hanged himself. The commandant became silent for a moment, and then the SS soldiers, even though no command had been issued, ran up to the remaining 11 and pulled the stools from under them before they, too, could express one final act of resistance.
Thank you. classified Poles as subhumans and had adopted a policy committed to the destruction and deportation of all Polish citizens. On the eve of the invasion, Hitler held a meeting with his high officials. He said, "I have placed my deathbed formations in readiness with orders to send to death mercilessly and without compassion men, women, and children of Polish derivation and language. Only thus shall we gain living space that we need." During the invasion, Hitler deployed special action squads that concentrated on eliminating any form of Polish resistance. In addition to his genocidal policy, which had targeted all of Poland's 3.3 million Jews, he required that any Polish citizens considered capable of emerging as a leader in resisting the German occupation of Poland also be eliminated. This group of condemned Poles became known as the Polish intelligentsia and was comprised largely of wealthy landowners, government officials, university professors, doctors, teachers, priests, and journalists. Hitler spoke, "Poles may have only one master. Two masters cannot exist side by side, and this is why all members of the Polish intelligentsia must be killed." Tens of thousands of intelligentsia were murdered in mass executions or sent to prisons or concentration camps. Another Nazi policy aimed at weakening resistance efforts was that of separating family members from one another. Separation instilled fear and effectively demoralized Poles, weakening their resolve to resist. Between 1939 and 1945, at least 1.5 million Polish citizens were separated from their families and transported to the Reich to perform forced labor. Many were teenage boys and girls.
It was 1942, and I was 18 years old. The Nazis had come to our home to take me away, but I was not there. When I returned home, my mother quickly dressed me as an old woman and took me to the country where she hid me in the attic of a family I did not even know. 3 days later, my mother received an official letter from the mayor of our town. It stated that if I did not appear, my family would be evacuated from the town and shot. My mother came to where I was hiding and showed me the letter, begging me not to go, but I knew what I must do. There were 19 other teenage girls from my town on a military bus that took us to a nearby camp, where we were examined by male German doctors. Once we were declared healthy, SS soldiers escorted us to a range and crammed us into a cabin. Then, with a clanging jolt, the train began to roll us away from all that we loved.
Thank you. In the camp, songs accompanied a person from birth until death. It was 1942, and I had just been delegated to work at the women's hospital in Brzezinka. I remember it well because six children were born in the camp hospital on that day, and their story still burns bright in my memory. Six women had come in on a transport from Lublin, and all six were in the late stages of their pregnancies. After the births of their newborns, each mother tried to have her child with her for at least a moment to feel how it is to be a mother and to bond with her child at such a time of misery. Each woman believed that since she had been allowed to give birth to her child would be allowed to live. Because there were women of various nationalities at that block, each mother sang songs for her own child in her native tongue. Many times, they sang sentimental lullabies which, perhaps, they had sung to other children before. They sang their songs next to the cradles, just like all the other women in the world. One morning, upon arriving at the hospital, I learned that the six babies had been needled. Needled was a slang term that we used to describe the fatal, poisonous shots administered by long needles directly into the heart. The mothers also received the deadly shots.
Thank you.
the tender words of our farewell moment soothe your pain. Because when your hand caressed my temple, all sorrow and grief went away. Let your pain, O mother, be rewarded, and let the tears be kissed away from your eyes. I miss your caress and your sweet words so much that a bitter tear of yearning trembles in my eyes again. Oh, mother, I would like so much to be a child again, like years before, and hide again in your arms. After you kissed me farewell on my forehead, I faced a horribly evil world far away from me. Day after day passes.